So we do a behavioral study, which is we do a very extensive battery of tests to describe and characterize the patient's hearing loss and tinnitus, and this is the place where we do it. So this is a sound attenuating chamber, or in lay language, what we call soundproof chamber. So we can't really have soundproof chamber, but this is what we can attenuate up to 55 decibels in here. And we monitor the participant from outside. They'll sit some over here, and we use these headphones behind me, and we run through all these tests. We do the standard hearing test, and we do all these other elaborate tests to characterize their hearing loss and their tinnitus. So there are different types of tinnitus people can come up with. They can come up with different types of hearing loss. So we do all that. We try to match the loudness of the sound they're hearing. We try to match the pitch of the sound they're hearing. And that takes about 2 to 3 hours. For the tinnitus subject, it takes about 3 hours. So as you can see, this is somewhat of a roomy booth. And this was on purpose because we installed it sort of with bigger dimensions because we wanted the participant, who tend to be older and elderly, to be more comfortable as they're sitting in this room. We also look at the anatomy of the brain. So we are looking at other changes in gray matter structures, the size of it, the volume of it, if you have had hearing loss and chronic tinnitus. The other thing is, are there changes in the white matter tracts? Are the connectivity patterns are changing? And we are finding that in our research, that indeed the gray matter structures are changing, which are these cells, and then the pathways are also changing because you have hearing loss. But what is somewhat surprising in my research is that I'm finding that hearing loss impacts these changes a lot more than tinnitus even. So that is another puzzle that we want to continue to investigate as we go on and run more subjects. We want to see how much of a contributory factor is hearing loss in this puzzle and how much is just having this ringing in the ears. Because they're so, they go together all the time. So 90% of people with tinnitus have hearing loss. So we want to sort of delineate the two, sort of dissociate them, differentiate them, and see what is the contribution of one? Can we address that? If we address the hearing loss, how much of an impact does it have? And then how best can we address tinnitus by itself? We construct elaborate programs which mimic the hearing loss status, which mimic somebody having tinnitus. So we started off with having normal auditory processing, and then what we do is we give it hearing loss to the model, we give it tinnitus, which is a bit like giving the minor seizure, and then we see what happens. How does things change? If you have sudden sensory deprivation, if you have a loss of hearing, and what happens? How do you react to it? How does your brain now adjust to it? Understanding this kind of diversity in the population is, I believe, the first step at getting at therapies. We have some ways of managing tinnitus, in some ways of alleviating the problems associated with it, but there is no cure for it. There is not a pill you can take and 2 weeks later there is no noise in your head. We don't have that. We have therapies like masking noises, for instance, or anti-anxiety or antidepressant drugs, which may help you manage it, which may help you feel a little better about it. But they are temporary in some cases, and yet the noise does not necessarily go. Right now, what we find is that about 40% of people with hearing loss get tinnitus, and we don't know why. Why doesn't everybody with hearing loss get tinnitus? And then what is the difference between this 40% and the other 60%? So that's one of the primary thrusts of my research, is to find these differences. And once we find these differences, how can we use it in prevention? How can we better use it in developing therapies? Well, I have family members with tinnitus, so it will mean a tremendous amount to me, because then I'm alleviating their problems. It So professionally, it will mean a lot because, you know, on a larger scale, I'm alleviating all the patients I see, all the subjects that sit and talk to me for hours talking about the four different types of sounds they're hearing and how it bothers them. So I want to be able to help them on that level. I want to, a personal level, I want to help the family members who have it. So it helps on a number of levels.